These were the first tandem rotor helicopters used by the US Armed Forces. Though their development started during World War II, they paved the way for the later big twin rotor transport helicopters, and the designs based on these early models were used for decades by many countries. They were the Piasecki HRP-1, HRP-2, and the H-21 models, the so-called flying bananas. So let's see the history of these helicopters today. Though helicopter developments were well underway on both sides of the Atlantic during World War II, the resulting designs were mostly smaller vehicles, like the Sikorsky R-4 in the US or the Flettner FL-282 in Germany. There were experiments with larger twin rotor helicopters as well, like the Plettlepage XR-1 or the German FA-223, but these often ran into problems because of their insufficient engine power and complicated construction. If you're interested in the history of these early designs, I have already made videos covering them. You can find the links in the description. While the US Army and the Air Force actively pursued helicopter developments, the Navy neglected this area for quite a while. But after a 1943 Senate hearing, they were instructed to look for suitable designs. But since the main helicopter manufacturers, Sikorsky and Plettlepage, already were on Army contracts and had no free manufacturing or development capacity, the Navy turned towards smaller designers. One of those was Frank Piasecki, a young engineer who earlier worked at the Kellett Auto Gyro Company and later at Plettlepage as a control engineer on the XR-1 design, and built years of experience with autogyros and helicopters. His first working design, the PV-2, was a small single-rotor aircraft, which flew in April 1943. Though this flight was actually not intentional, the helicopter was lifted off accidentally during a tune-up test, and thus by accident it became the second helicopter to fly in the US. The Navy was interested in more powerful designs, which could be used for troop transport or rescue missions. So when Piasecki proposed an unprecedented large twin-rotor transport helicopter to them, which could carry 8 passengers or around 2,000 pounds of cargo at 100 miles an hour speed, they were very interested. In October 1943, the Piasecki PV-2 was demonstrated at the Washington National Airport, and its construction and flight performance impressed the Navy officials. So in January 1944, his company was awarded a contract to develop his large twin-rotor design. Though the new design, the PV-3, had a fairly strange look, it was a culmination of Piasecki's earlier experiences. While he was working at the Plettlepage company on the XR-1 design, he noticed that the side-by-side twin-rotor configuration worked better flying sideways, and it also needed strong pylons to support the rotors, which added unwanted weight and drag. Two problems which could be both avoided if the rotors would be installed in tandem. He also raised the tail of his helicopter to keep the two rotors from touching and to keep the downwash of the front rotor away from the rear one, resulting in the distinctive look of the helicopter, which soon earned it the nickname the Flying Banana. The PV-3 was the largest helicopter when it was completed, with 47 feet 3 inches length and using two 41 feet rotors, and having an empty weight of 4,279 pounds. The design had a conventional construction, with a steel tube frame and fabric covering, and it was powered by a single 450 horsepower Continental radial engine, mounted at the rear of the helicopter. Though this design was different from earlier experiments and had a lot of promise, this didn't mean it was simple. The long fuselage housed a two-man cockpit with tandem seating, and to drive the two main rotors with a single engine, it used a series of drive shafts and three transmissions. As the complicated design came from a small company, the Navy chose a backup in case it fails. Interestingly, the backup model they picked was the McDonnell XHJD-1 Whirlaway, a design based on the earlier failed Plettlepage XR-1, which Piasecki also worked on. But the McDonnell design showed the same problems the XR-1 had in the past, and it was eventually cancelled. Meanwhile, the PV-3 made its maiden flight in March 1945. And during the test flights, it managed to reach a speed of 95 miles an hour and lift 1,800 pounds of weight. The first unit was kept as a company property, so it received the Navy designation XHRP-X, where the second X indicated it was a company prototype, while later Navy models were designated XHRP-1. During this time, the company received another contract from the Navy for a smaller six-seat helicopter. This design was the XHJP-1, which became the HUP-1 Retriever, but we will take a look at that model in a separate video later. The first flights of the PV-3 were done without the fabric covering on the body, which was later applied, improving the speed of the aircraft. As with most early helicopters, this design had many teething problems as well. The first prototype had very heavy controls, but that was quickly corrected by the engineers. And as it was found over the testing, the transmissions needed much higher quality parts than the initially used automotive components, which caused several malfunctions until they were replaced. By 1946, two additional prototypes were finished for the Navy, from which the second one was the pre-production version for the HRP-1. These variants were upgraded to 600 horsepower Pratt & Whitney engines. The testing was satisfactory, and the Navy ordered 20 production models in 1947. Most of these were supplied to the Marine Corps, where being the first helicopter with sufficient carrying capacity, they were used to develop helicopter assault tactics. They remained in service until 1953, but the experiences with the HRP-1 soon led to an improved variant, the HRP-2, which featured a revised, more streamlined fuselage with an all-metal skin, and more importantly, an improved cockpit. The original design's cockpit was positioned closer to the center of gravity. However, experiences on the HRP-1 showed that the pilots usually pivoted the helicopter around the cockpit. So on the new variant, it was moved forward, giving better visibility to the pilots, who were now sitting side by side. The HRP-2 was 7 feet longer than its predecessor, and thanks to its better aerodynamics, its speed increased to 105 miles an hour. But the redesign and the new fuselage increased the weight of the HRP-2 with more than 1,000 pounds. And because it used the same 600 horsepower engine, it could now only carry 5 troops, which given the size of the helicopter, was not economical. In the end, only 5 units were built from this variant, but the new fuselage and cockpit arrangement served as a base for the new, more powerful H-21 model. After the success of the HRP-1, in 1949, Piasecki proposed their new H-21 model to the US Air Force. This helicopter was based on the HRP-2 design and was initially intended as an Arctic rescue aircraft to operate in harsh weather conditions and temperatures as low as minus 54 Celsius. The new design was an all-metal construction and finally featured a powerful engine to fit the size of the fuselage. The new 1,150 horsepower Wright R1820 engine greatly increased the helicopter's lifting capacity and speed over its predecessor. The new model made its maiden flight in April 1952 and lived up to the expectations. The speed of the new helicopter increased to 125 miles an hour and its cargo capacity to 20 troops. The Air Force was interested in the design, and after the test flights, they ordered 32 search and rescue H-21A variants and 163 H-21B troop transport variants. The production A version used a 1,250 horsepower engine, while the B model featured an even more powerful variant, developing 1,425 horsepower, resulting in a lifting capacity fitting for its size, as it could carry 20 troops. The Army also placed orders for the new helicopter, which they designated H-21C. The type was accepted into service in 1953, and in the same year it set an altitude record with 22,100 feet, and 2 days later a speed record with 146 miles an hour. In August 1956, it became the first helicopter to accomplish a non-stop cross-country flight in 37 hours. Sadly, Piasecki was not able to enjoy the success, as in the same year he was forced out of his company, which became the Vertol Corporation, and later in 1960 it was acquired by Boeing. This helicopter was 52 feet 6 inches long and used 2 44 feet diameter rotors. It had an empty weight of 8,650 pounds and a maximum takeoff weight of 15,200 pounds. It was powered by a single air-cooled Wright R1820 engine, producing 1,425 horsepower. With this engine, it could reach a top speed of 127 miles an hour and had a cruise speed of 98 miles an hour. Its combat range was 265 miles and had a service ceiling of 9,450 feet. The helicopter could carry 20 fully equipped troops, and optionally they were armed with 50 caliber or 7.62mm door machine guns. The YH-21 models were the service test variants, 18 were built. The following H-21A model was the production service and rescue variant, with upgraded 1250 horsepower engines. The H-21B model was the troop transport version, featuring 1425 horsepower engine and limited armor protection. 163 were built for the US forces, 10 for Japan, and 10 for France. The SH-21B was a rescue version of the H-21B. The Army version was the H-21C model. 333 were built for the US forces and 98 for the French Air Force. The XH-21D was a test version, built with two turboshaft engines, but it didn't go to production. And finally, the civilian variants of the helicopter were named Model 42A and 44A, B, and C. After entering service, the type saw extensive use in many different roles, mostly as a transport, but it was also used in the cold northern regions by the US Air Force and the Royal Canadian Air Force to maintain the early warning radar sites. There were also medevac variants, the Marine Corps evaluated them for aerial assault, and several experimental versions were tested for gunship operations, with different door guns and even flexible guns under the nose. The first combat use of the type, however, happened in the Algerian War by the French forces, who ordered 98 of the type. Flying missions along with the smaller Sikorsky H-34 types, the H-21 was tested as a gunship, featuring fixed machine guns and rocket pods. But soon it was found they lacked maneuverability for those missions, and they were just used as troop transports, equipped with different door guns, either 50 caliber machine guns or 20mm cannons. In 1961, the type was deployed to South Vietnam, where again they flew transport missions, being the only big helicopter that could transport a whole squadron together. They were again armed with different door guns, either 7.62mm or 50 caliber machine guns. But despite using self-sealing fuel tanks, the big helicopter proved to be vulnerable to enemy fire, especially its unprotected control cables and fuel lines. In 1962, the type was redesignated to CH-21. Originally designed for cold weather conditions, the CH-21 also ran into performance and reliability issues in the hot and dusty South Vietnam. The engines had lower output in the hot climate, resulting in reduced lifting capacity, so they were often overstressed, and only lasted about 200 hours. By 1964, the new Bell UH-1 Huey entered service, which could perform many of the roles better than the CH-21. But the smaller Bell design couldn't fully replace them, as it could only carry a maximum of 5 troops. The CH-21 was used alongside the Huey until the arrival of the new CH-47 Chinook in 1965, which was a true replacement for the type. Later that year, they were called back from Vietnam, and finally, in 1967, the type was fully retired. Interestingly, their replacement, the Chinook, was actually a descendant of the CH-21, as by that time, Boeing acquired the former Piasecki Corporation. Though the Flying Bananas were early designs, and they had a relatively short service life, the helicopters built by Boeing after them, like the CH-47 Chinook and the CH-46 Sea King, all carried their legacy, and many of them are still in use today. Hope you guys enjoyed this video. Please leave a like, subscribe to my channel, and in the comments let me know if there's any interesting events or vehicles you'd like to see.